Yeah, I mean, Paul was ideal to work to do the first two albums. I mean, he had a good attitude and he had a good voice for that period of the band. But I think, like all bands, you know, bands change, they move slightly, they go in, you know, different directions, and some person will leave, some person will come in, and it just changes. I mean, that's familiar to all bands.
They really were on the verge of something pretty major. They were just about to break through into America. To keep Paul in the group at that point probably would have been a recipe for disaster.
But it was a worry to actually change singers at that point because things were really taking off for us. And, you know, but I think if we hadn't changed, it would have been even worse. You know, like another album or so down the line, it would have been a lot worse. So I think the time was probably the right thing to do.
Everybody needs a bit of luck, and the bit of luck they had was that Bruce Dickinson himself had been watching Maiden from afar.
At that time, I remember standing there going, oh, you know, if I was singing for that band, that would... We could do something really, really cool. We could do something really, really different. It could go somewhere else if I was singing. And I don't think that a metal band has quite been there before.
We knew how good a vocalist he was. It was just a question of whether he'd suit our material, really.
Steve and I went down to Reading Festival where Samson were playing on the bill there. And then afterwards, I sort of dragged him out of the bar and we had a very quiet chat, so no one could see us.
And there was one large central post with a bright bloody floodlight straight down like that, surrounded by bars full of loads of gossiping musicians and journalists. So in the middle of this field, underneath the only bright spotlight by a large pole, he gets hold of me and goes, blah, 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 blah. We're animated in discussion with each other. Everybody's going, oh, look, there's Iron Maiden's new singer, you know.
Bruce coming in made us be able to go, right, we can just go where we want to go.
Cost you a thing with all this smoke, you're still out there!
Yeah!
Yeah! You want some more?
Yeah! I love his voice, his whole on-stage presence, the way he talked to the audience.
This is a song which gentleman over there, Adrian Smith, who's at the moment suffering from a few sore ribs, from the older Adrian Smith helped to write on the new album. It's a song all about a lady called Charlotte the Harlot.
Well, that's quite an interesting story. I mean, that idea was something I came up with when I was very young. It was just, you know, one of those first kind of songs you write. And I had this band Urchin, and we did this song, 22.
We discovered where she lived. And we discovered she's running a new knocking shop somewhere in the East End of London at a gas. If you care to visit it, it's at 22 Acacia Avenue!
It's just basically where she lived. Supposedly or not, depending on what you believe or what you, whatever. We've been asked many questions about this, but obviously we can't say too much about it as to the real person or as to whether she was called Charlotte or not. So just leave it at that, I think.
Seven years later, you know, when I was in the band, he said, hey, I remember seeing you over this festival and you played this song, 22 Acacia Avenue, let's do something with that.
Maidenized it with all the different time changes and this and that.
It ended up being on the record and being part of our live set for two or three tours. And it was a song that I wrote, you know, when I was 18 and I'd sort of forgotten about it, you know. It just showed it ended up on a platinum-selling album. Incredible.
Yeah.
is a way of life heavy metal. It's Iron Maiden, Megadeth, AC/DC, Metallica, all these bands. It stands for something. And it's not just the music, it's the lifestyle.
My life is my own. Well, here I am in the village. And when I was a kid, I used to watch this series, The Prisoner, and I wondered what on earth it was trying to say. Because when I was a kid, I didn't feel as if I really had anywhere that I belonged. So when The Prisoner turns round and says, "I'm not a number, I'm a free man," I want that to be me. Be seeing you.
Okay. Solid.
Prisoner started off track in a rehearsal room in Hackney, and the drummer wasn't there. He was around having a cup of tea. So being a frustrated drummer my whole life, I started like bashing out this pretty dead simple drum beat at the beginning. And then I think it was Adrian started like playing this riff, and then Harry came in and went, "Wow, what a great riff." And then we just started. Clive's drum beat in it is a real like swing time drum beat. It's not like the bog standard heavy metal drum beat.
Let's put that back in the track.
Everyone got a chance to just give their expressions and their all, really, to the whole thing.
Obviously, we wanted to be really sort of dramatic with the intro, so we thought, well, maybe we can snip the intro tape off the Prisoner TV series.
It was quite funny because we had to get permission from Patrick McGoohan for the intro of Prisoner, because we didn't realise at the time that he actually owned the rights to it all. So Rod, our manager, had to actually get on to him and personally, and they had to phone him in Malibu or somewhere, wherever he was, I don't know.
Now, Rod Smallwood, you see, is probably, well, I wouldn't call him a man who is easily intimidated by anybody, but I've never heard him so nervous in all my life as when he had to phone up Patrick McGoohan.
So I managed to get his number and rang him up and explained, you know, what we wanted to do, who Iron Maiden were, because he wouldn't know who we were.
Anyway, calls him up, quotes the line, gets it completely wrong. He's like, "Hello, Rod Smallwood here from Iron Maiden, and we want to do a song. I'm not a number. I'm a prisoner. I'm a free man. Something like that." And I'm like going, no. He's going to tell you to piss off in a minute. You've got the words all wrong. He's going to freak out.
So I was terrified. All the band were in the office. I'm going, shouting it sort of to Patrick McGoohan, you know. And after I explained it, there's the pregnant pause for about 5 seconds. And then he said, "Do it.
Do it." And it was just, "Oh, thank you very much." That was it. Top man!
Which is very, if people know McGoohan, I mean, that's very, very Patrick McGoohan. So it's like, yeah, you know.
And then we just said to Rob, "Well, you know, why were you so nervous?" And he said, "Well, he's a real superstar, not like you assholes."